Christopher Hendon from the University of Oregon. He will discuss how chemistry can give you the perfect shot of espresso every time. Dr. Hendon?
Good morning. Firstly, thank you for the opportunity to talk about my work in the public avenue. This is a side project, truth be told. However, it's become one of the major research focuses in my career. I should give some context to how I got here. So I originally started in the coffee industry in 2014 through an avenue called the Barista Championships, the World Barista Championships, where myself and a colleague proceeded to win the best barista in the United Kingdom 2 years back to back, and then come fifth in the world. And then we took a year off to do some research and science, and then I moved to the United States, where then last year I worked with the American Barista Champion, who then went on to win the United States, and then with that pursuit to become sixth in the world. So I have not yet finished this, I'm not done. But the underlying problem in the Barista Championship, that's how I was introduced to it, was reproducibility. So the best chefs in the world, Michelin star chefs, are awarded the Michelin star because number one, the food is good, but number two, it's always good. And that's extremely challenging to do in espresso because what you're doing is you're grinding an amorphous material. You're then compacting it into some sort of granular packed bed, and then you're forcing water through it. And water is lazy, so it will always find the fastest way to get from the top to the bottom. And so if you have a variable particle size distribution, or if you have imperfect machinery such that the water is not flowing homogeneously through the bed, you end up with regions of coffee that are over-extracted and other regions which are under-extracted. And now, it doesn't sound like that big a deal, it's just a shot of espresso. But it turns out that there's a tremendous amount of coffee consumed in the United States annually. So in 2015, the industry as a whole, including cups, roasting, importing, all these things, amounted to about $225 billion of revenue, which is 1.5% of US GDP. So a 1% difference in the shot of espresso makes a tangible difference in our day-to-day lives beyond that cup. So what I did for this particular project was I examined how espresso would be, we call it pulled, but let's say an extraction. So we pull a shot of espresso and you taste it or you quantify it with a high performance liquid chromatography or you quantify it through mass, so just how much of the coffee is in there by mass. And you see if you did exactly the same thing 100 times, what the variation was in extracting mass, in flavor, and these sorts of things. And we quickly realized that we are not achieving an optimal extraction for espresso because by the virtue of, I guess you could say, history, we have rules that said the shot has to run in 25 to 35 seconds. And now because of that, we were grinding finer and finer and finer to achieve this arbitrary number that was, I guess, grandfathered into the industry. In this particular paper that I'll present tomorrow, we demonstrate that you can actually achieve exactly the same extraction in 6 seconds. But what's important about that is in the 6 second shot, you have to grind it completely different. You have to grind a lot finer. And so historically, people would say that is not espresso. But actually, what it allows you to do is pump water homogeneously through the bed. So no longer are you achieving over-extraction in some regions, under-extraction in other regions, but rather extracting exactly what you want to extract in 6 seconds. The practical outcome of that, of course, is you increase speed, you increase reproducibility, so you increase the value overall of the product. But what's really interesting is that using the same process, we can then actually systematically reduce the amount of coffee that we're using. Because previously, if we were under-extracting in some regions and over-extracting in other regions, we would say, okay, we've achieved a flavor profile where we've extracted, let's say, 4 grams from 20 grams, but actually only 15 grams of that was excessive. So with that knowledge, we can then go back and systematically reduce the amount of coffee we're using per espresso shot by maybe, let's say, 25%. And by doing that, you maintain the same flavor profile exactly as what you prefer originally with a more variable method. But you are able to reduce your coffee mass expenditure tremendously to a point where a little store, like perhaps the one down the street that you might go to all the time, if they implemented this method, it would save them about, on average, about $40,000 a year in raw product, which is a really big deal for a cafe whose turnover is some tangible amount. But if every single cafe were to implement the systematic production of coffee and improvement of reproducibility, we're looking at some saving like $300 million a year on just the raw product, with no sacrifice or detriment to the cup that you then eventually consume. So this was the basis of the U.S. Barista Championship routine that we went through last year and ended up going sixth. And I guess the important point here is that this is a really tangible thing that you can actually taste. So a lot of the chemistry that we talk about, in fact, most of the chemistry in my life, I haven't been able to quantify it by taste. In fact, you're not supposed to do that, right? So, but in this one, people come and say, oh, I can't really taste the difference. The reality is, I've never done an experiment with somebody and shown them that I can improve the reproducibility while reducing the coffee mass and then disliking the product. Whether your flavor profile is preferences for dark roasted coffee and more sweetness, or if you like acidity, this is not really the point. It's just to achieve that same profile to us. So we're really excited about this work. And I guess that's what I got for now. We'll definitely take some questions.
Yeah, at this point, we'd like to open it up for any questions. So we have a microphone coming around. When it comes to you, please state your name and affiliation, and then ask your question.
Hi, so it's Kath O'Driscoll from Chemistry and Industry magazine. Can you say what sort of is the optimum size of the particles that you need then to get this optimum kind of flavor reproducibility?
Yeah. So one of the problems with coffee is it was once plant material, so it was made of cells. And then when we roast it, we lose pretty much all the water and everything that's inside these cells. So you end up with a carbonized shell with nothing in the middle, so it's porous. But it's also amorphous. So when you grind it, every time you fracture a particle and then it exits the grinder, dust is formed at that interface. And now you can think of it like a power series, if you like, where you fracture one particle and the next one fractures, and eventually it's small enough to fit out. But every time you crack that thing, you end up with dust. Now, what that results in is the big particles are Gaussian distributed, which makes sense. But the little particles are all the same size, and there's just an increasing population of them. The dust size on average is 20 micron in diameter. But the larger particles are determined by the aperture of your burrs. Now, there is a tipping point. So you grind fine enough, and at some point your population of dust is so large that it starts to clog, and that's the origin of this inhomogeneous extraction. Which is, of course, counterintuitive, because surface area goes up as you grind finer and finer. So people would historically think grinding finer would give you more extraction. But indeed, that's not true. So there is not a best grind setting, per se, because number one, it's dependent on the physical structure of the burrs that you're using. I guess that would be what the manufacturers would call proprietary. You can, of course, look at them. What they are actually doing, I don't really know. We can only observe the product. But there's another variable that's coffee dependent too. So for example, Kenyan coffees are more dense physically than Ethiopian coffees. And so when you grind them, you end up perhaps having more extractable surface area or less. It's not very clear exactly what you need to do. But the point is that if you keep the grind setting fixed and use two different coffees, there's a good chance that grind setting will be perhaps sufficient for one and insufficient for the other one. So these are the challenges that you'll see baristas and other people in the shops.
So are you looking to design a different type of grinder, or have you got some advice on how these grinders should be redesigned in order to overcome this problem?
Yeah, so actually I have an ongoing collaboration with a German manufacturer for these grinders, and one of the challenges is that it's actually, we don't really have design principles for these grinders. There's a lot of trial and error. And the reason for that is because I guess there hasn't been a tremendous influx of academic interest in this area. Not because we're not interested, it's just because it's an oversight. So I suspect that will change, but at the moment, that's where we're at.
Can you say anything about the design, or is that kind of proprietary at the
moment? Oh, of course. There's three types of grinders, but there's only two that really matter. So the least important one is the whirly blade grinder where you push on the top and you hope for the best. That one, they are by far the worst, because what we were talking about earlier about making dust every time you fracture a particle, well, that And that's a problem because you want the dust then to exit the grinding chamber. But in the Whirlybird wines, it just keeps fracturing. So you end up with absolutely tiny, tiny particles and also old beans sitting in the same. We've all seen this. The other two grinding apparatus you can use are, there's a so-called conical bird, which is essentially a drill bit that has a bezel around it. And so you use gravity to pull the coffee down, and eventually it exits through the opening of the drill bit and its bezel. The other type is a flat bird grinder, and it's essentially two burrs. One is fixed, one is rotating, or because of relativity, they're both whatever. You get the idea. And the coffee is fed into the middle of the flat burr, and then it meets some of these pre-breakers on the outside. Eventually, the coffee progresses its way out in a sort of a cylindrical fashion, and you determine the grind size by moving them apart like this, so the coffee sprays out the outside. Now, the physical structure of the flat burrs is a big breaker, so it looks like big teeth that come by each other like that. Then you have littler teeth that are then used to cut. But then they have found that if you then have teeth that are pointing the other direction, at the very end, maybe like a millimeter or two of them, they call those polishing burrs, and that seems to work. But as you can see, I mean, I would never have arrived at that myself just by, you know, by knowledge of how this would grind. It was, you know, it's been arrived empirically.
Thank you.
Ben Hall for Chemistry World magazine. Looking at the HPLC analysis you've done, how does a 30-second extraction with, you know, sort of relatively unevenly ground beans compare with your 6-second extraction with the very well controlled beef?
Yeah, so that's a good question. Recently, we've produced some data that demonstrates that some stuff in coffee is not that soluble. So, in fact, when you brew coffee, there's a lot of coffee left on top of, you know, your pour over or whatever. Some stuff is extremely soluble, like, for example, citric acid. Any of the acids in coffee dissolve almost instantaneously. The way we went about quantifying the differences in a long extraction versus a short one would be looking at a couple of representative compounds who we know solubility is limited by kinetics, in other words, time, of course. And it turns out, actually, that caffeine is a really great example of this. So caffeine soluble, it's poorly soluble in water. I mean, I think it's like 20 grams per liter, but we should check that value. But what is important is that it's kinetically limited, so it takes a long time. And so by using caffeine as a barometer for the extraction, instead of extraction, we can actually see that less soluble compounds in water do not exist in the fast shot, and longer shots of espresso have more of these less soluble compounds. We'll return to the implication of that in one moment, but the most extreme example of this is a so-called cold brew, which uses a brew time of something like hours. And so in cold brew, you see extremely high concentrations of things that were kinetically limited. That's why cold brew is so high in caffeine, is because you're giving it the opportunity to solvate all these compounds. That's also why cold brew has a totally different flavor profile to any of the other coffees we've experienced, because you're extracting things that simply are kinetically limited in espresso or in pour over or whatever. Now, it turns out we like the flavor of oxygen-decorated carbonates. In other words, soluble compounds. And we don't really like tarry, ashy sort of compounds that show up from roasting. Now, the latter are the ones that are kinetically limited. They taste bitter, they taste burnt and acrid, and so on. So actually, by increasing the shot time, you end up excluding some of those flavors that we don't typically enjoy. Now, if you enjoy those, that's absolutely fine too. Maybe you can think of still improving that shot time by going fast, but roasting it in a different way to develop more of those flavors.
And in terms of sort of consistency and so on, what is the most important factor? Because you've got temperature, you've got pressure, you've got dissolved minerals, you've got grain size, you've got exposure time. All of these factors obviously play a part.
Right.
Is there one that just overrides everything else? If you wanted to try at home with commercially available kit to make sure you're getting consistency, what should be the one thing you should try and control?
Yeah, so that's I have two answers to this. So, fundamentally, let's assume that you're the average coffee consumer. You already know what you like. So I'm not going to tell you to go and buy all these other things. But I know, like my father, for example, can brew the cup of coffee that he likes every single time. And the one thing that he changed and improved it vastly was a scale, a balance, by weighing the mass of coffee and weighing the mass of water, so you could then get the ratio of hot water to coffee correct every time. Now, for example, if you're just a home user, you want to use about 16 grams of water per gram of coffee, and then you can play with it from there. So the biggest shortcoming that most people do is they use too little coffee. So if that what I've just told you, the 16 to 1, manifests as about 20 grams of coffee per cup of coffee. And that's a lot, actually. It's bigger than what I can hold in my hand. I'm at 18.9, my hand is. It's good for camping. But the point is this, is that that's the number one thing you could improve on. But actually, if we were in a setting where you were open to the idea of accessing different flavor profiles, and so perhaps me taking you down a path of a Sumatran coffee that might have flavor notes of tobacco and other things like this, the number one thing that you can do to improve your coffee, assuming that you've kept everything else constant, is to buy a higher quality grain product. It's an agricultural product, and so just like everything else in agriculture, the more you spend on it, typically the higher quality is, and by quality in agriculture, we mean not a one-off, but reproducibility. Specifically, there's many defects that occur in coffee. We have so-called potato defect, which is found typically number one in coffee. You know instantly, you roast it, then you grind it, and it smells like a wet potato. That shows up one in about every 1,000 beans, but we've actually got better at mitigating that problem. So these sorts of things are reduced with a higher quality coffee.
The amount of coffee beans that are wasted, and I'm just wondering, because there's a trend for people to use more of these machines at home and different things as well, just for standard coffees. I mean, could this type of technology also have any application? Could it extrapolate? Do you think we're not brewing other coffees correctly, you know, with the machines in hotels or at home?
Yeah, so absolutely. So at home, the typical user at home would have some sort of capsule-based machine, so like an espresso or a Keurig or something. Those two machines are dissimilar, but let's just assume those are the ones that everybody has. Those machines are dissimilar, so the Keurig targets making a filter coffee, a larger cup, while the espresso targets making a shorter cup. You'll actually note that the Nespresso comes out as an unusual beverage because it's not as dilute as a filter coffee, but it's not as concentrated as a coffee that you might find in the shop. To put numbers on it, in this particular cup, this has got probably about 1.2% coffee solids by mass, and the rest of it's water and minerals. In espresso, it's typically around 7 to 10%. An espresso pod produces one at around, let's say, 4 to 5%. So it's extremely rare to have a flavor profile like that in a cafe, because they can achieve more. Now, what the limiting factor is, based on the previous discussion about a 16-to-1 ratio, is that an espresso pod can hold 6.2 grams of coffee. So if you extract 20%, which is, let's say, on average, about what you want to extract by mass, you're looking at 20% of 6.2 grams, which you can do the math, it's about 1.5 grams, let's say, of coffee. And 1.5 grams of coffee in a ratio of 16 to 1 gives you a beverage which is very, very small. And so people want the volume for the espresso. They want a drink that doesn't look like a drop of coffee in a cup. So that's why we target the 5%er. Concentration. But with that in mind, if we could more efficiently extract from our coffee, even in that setting, then what we're doing is, by pushing it even 1%, that changes everything, because that takes it from a 5% cup to a 6% cup, that's a big difference, right? And so we're looking at the implications there. With the Keurig example, they can hold much larger amounts of coffee, something like, you know, let's say 10 plus grams. In that example, you have a lot more room to play, because you've got a lot more coffee. So yes, there as well. Hopefully I illustrated why that might be. There is actually ongoing projects between myself and a few other industry members and those companies as well. We're working together to try and bring better coffee to everybody, right? This is not like a high profile only sort of coffee experience.
German sort of design grinders come onto the marketplace?
So you can purchase these German grinders. They're extremely expensive, actually. And the reason is that the burrs are made of, typically they're made of titanium. And when they're machining the burrs, the cost to associate with using these diamond-tipped bits is extremely expensive. And so what it results in, actually, is the high-end grinders that I work on are, let's say, $2,000. But you can get away with a grinder made by an American company for $220, which is still a lot of money, right? That's I'm not advocating going out and investing a tremendous amount of money in equipment, but it costs about $220 to reach that minimum level of what we would say is acceptable. But I want to counter my own comment there and say that actually the most important thing, the way that we grade quality coffee in the industry, has nothing to do with the grinder. What we do is we just grind the coffee arbitrarily at a coarse setting. We put it in a cup and we pour hot water in it. We wait for 4 minutes. We remove some of the floaty bits on there and then we drink it with a spoon. And the idea here is that we minimize the dependence of the brew method. As it turns out, the brew method is about, let's say, 10% of the overall picture of what that coffee can be. And so while that's the part that we engage in and we romanticize about as the consumer, that's probably the least important part in achieving the most reproducible cup. So, it's an interesting problem.
Thank you.
We have an online question from Andy Atterbury. He's asking, is Hinden planning on doing research on other brewing methods besides espresso, like a pour over, full immersion, such as French press?
Yeah, so actually that's a nice compliment to what we were just discussing. There's two general types of brew method. There's one with so-called full immersion, which is where the coffee is in contact with the water, completely surrounded by the water the entire time. So examples are a French press or an AeroPress or something like this. Then there's any percolation method. So espresso would be the most extreme example of that, where you push water through the bed. But a pour over is an example of a percolation method. There's also the percolator, which is, of course, the one where you put it on your stovetop. The short answer to this is I've done most of my work with espresso because it's a piece of equipment that doesn't really rely on the human as much. But actually, the full immersion method is the way that I quantify upper limits of extractions, because that full contact time allows us to get that time, the physical time, to extract all the caffeine, to know how much is actually in that bean, or to extract all of the citric acid or the linoleic acid or something like this. So I already do that. This particular study was targeting espresso because I believe that the American market is poised to start drinking more espresso. Right now it's a drip coffee community. And so I think that if you bring high technology to the American market in espresso, you're going to revolutionize how we consume coffee here. But that is not saying that I haven't done any work in the filter sector. I will advance that a little bit and say that as you grind finer to achieve higher surface area, like we were talking about before, for filter coffee, you have a secondary problem. This filter coffee, the water passes through the bed based on gravity. And so as you grind finer, your resistor, or your resistance, if you like, increases, and you start to plug this paper. And what the paper is a physical barrier between what is the drink and what is the coffee grinds. And it has a pretty well-defined aperture, so the paper lets water through its pores, and the pores are about 20 micron, and so at some point you start grinding too fine, you start plugging the pores with little pieces of dust, which happen to coincidentally be about 20 micron, and so your water doesn't flow anymore. So it's actually very challenging to dial in a filtered coffee that is a percolation method that doesn't have pressure behind it, because you then are limited by a lower limit in grind speed. So, I'm working on it, but it's a work in progress.
All right. Thank you all for coming. There will be an archived version of this session that will soon be posted at bit.ly/ACSLive_NOLA. And please join us for our next press conference at 10:30 a.m. today. That's